Good afternoon. The first item of business this afternoon is portfolio questions, and the portfolio this afternoon is social justice. I would make a plea again for succinct questions and answers to allow as many members to have the opportunity as possible. And at question number one, I call Russell Finlay.
Thank you. To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on its legal challenge to the decision of the UK Government to issue a Section 35 order in relation to the Gender Recognition Reform Scotland Bill.
Cabinet Secretary Shirley-Ann Somerville.
I gave a statement to this Parliament on the 19th of June on the reasons for the decision to challenge the UK Government's issue of a Section 35 order, which the Member was present for. In doing so, I noted the strict limits on what was possible for me to say in relation to that challenge, but that in the interest of transparency, we were intending to publish the terms of the Scottish Government's petition for judicial review. Following that statement, the petition was published in full on the Scottish Government website. As the Member will be aware, the Scottish Government cannot comment any further on what are now live legal proceedings.
Russell Finlay.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer. Now, 2 weeks ago, I asked the Cabinet Secretary to explain how the SNP can push its gender self-ID law while at the same time Hamza Yousaf says a rapist claiming to a woman is at it. The First Minister continues to tie himself up in knots over this fundamental contradiction. So will the Cabinet Secretary today confirm that the SNP cannot answer this question, because to do so would admit that their self-ID law is wide open to abuse by male sex criminals?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, as the Member in the Chamber will be well aware, the aspects around those that are in the prison estate often include individuals who do not have a gender recognition certificate, and therefore what is in the bill that was passed by the overwhelming majority of the members of this Parliament makes no change to the risk assessment which goes on in each individual case within the prison estate.
Question number two, Stephanie Callaghan.
To ask the Scottish Government when it last engaged with Social Security Scotland.
Cabinet Secretary.
As an agency of the Scottish Government, there is close engagement with Social Security Scotland on a daily basis. As Cabinet Secretary, I also meet regularly with the Chief Executive to maintain oversight over the activities of the agency. Thanks to this close collaboration, we have established a social security system based on the principles of dignity, fairness and respect. And we're now delivering 13 Scottish Government benefits, 7 of which are entirely new forms of financial support available only in Scotland.
Stephanie Callaghan.
I thank the First Minister for providing that clarity. As one of my constituents' application for adult disability payment claim was delayed due to their GP taking over 5 weeks to provide the key health information required for their application to progress. Will the Scottish Government explore additional options to enhance communications between Social Security Scotland and GP to promote quicker decisions and quicker payments that avoid lengthy waits? And is there potential to streamline IT systems at GP surgeries to speed up this processing?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, there are a number of avenues that the agency is looking to ensure that they progress so that people can have their applications decided as quickly as possible. Obviously, GPs are only one of the sources of information that Social Security Scotland can go to, and therefore the agency will give consideration whether it should be a GP or indeed another professional or indeed someone else who knows that individual client well enough to be able to provide that supporting information. The agency is also working with the partners such as GPs and GP practice managers to ensure that we are all learning from this still very new benefit that is now live.
Supplementary, Jeremy Balfour.
Thank you. There have been a growing number of reports over recent weeks of Social Security Scotland website not functioning properly, with a number of my constituents waiting hours for responses from web chats. What representations have been made to the Cabinet Secretary on how Social Security plans to fix these issues?
Cabinet Secretary.
There is a high demand both for web chat and on the telephone lines, and Social Security Scotland has already taken action to try and ensure that clients who are phoning in are receiving more timorous replies. We are also, or the agency is also, looking at what more can be done with the telephony system to improve the efficiency on that, and I will be happy to work with the member and provide further updates on that in due course as the agency develops.
And supplementary, Paul O'Kane.
Thank you very much. We heard dignity, fairness and respect, again, as the guiding principles of Social Security Scotland from the Cabinet Secretary, just as we did in 2019 when she spoke of the bill. Yeah, we know the Government has failed to deliver handing back Social Security powers, such as the administration of carers' allowance, until 2025, leaving thousands of Scots at the peril of the Tory-run DWP. And indeed, as we've just heard from Jeremy Balfour, there are serious issues in terms of call handling and web chats, 28,000 calls to Social Security with people waiting more than an hour. So I'm sure the Cabinet Secretary would reasonably recognise that that doesn't match that 2019 aspiration. And will she tell us what she's done since coming to post to review the operational performance of Social Security Scotland to ensure that it looks and acts like the system that was originally promised?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, clearly there had to be some changes to the timetable, which we made clear at the time, particularly because of the impact of COVID. And that was not just because of the challenges with the agency or with Scottish Government, but also the very understandable pressures that were on the DWP as they sought to assist people at the very start of that. And I do think that context needs to be borne in mind. I am heartened by the representations and discussion I had with another member from today when we talked about what was felt by people who are being responded to by the agency in a way, as this member reported to me, that they were felt they were being believed by the first time. So I think we should take heart from the fact that we are delivering a system that has dignity, fairness and respect at the heart. Yes, there is more to do. Yes, we have much more to do, for example, on the waiting times for the processing of adult disability. But the agency is taking action, and I have met with the Chief Executive, and we will continue to do so on a very regular basis as we work through even further actions that can be taken to improve that.
And supplementary, Beatrice Wishart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. 8 to 10 weeks was meant to be the maximum anyone would wait for adult disability payment, but this is becoming the average. Has the Scottish Government misjudged this timescale, and what's being done to address waits?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, we do have at this point a 4-month average processing time, and one of the aspects is a factor in this is that the agency, unlike in the DWP, the agency has responsibility for supporting information and the collation of that. And we heard from the original question from Stephanie Callaghan that it sometimes takes other agencies and other organisations some time to reply to Social Security Scotland with the source of information that will allow a decision to be taken. But that's exactly why the agency has already taken a number of steps to ensure that they are going to the right people. And it is important to ensure that we also make sure that we take our time, not too long, of course, but take the time to make sure that the eligibility is checked and the decision is the right one the first time round, because what we don't want to see is what we have in a PIP situation where many people were turned down and then had to take it onto appeal. So it is taking an unnecessarily long time at the moment, but the agency has a number of measures in place to ensure that that will improve.
Question number 3, Annie Wells.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government whether it has conducted any analysis of the potential cost to the public purse of introducing a minimum income guarantee.
Cabinet Secretary.
The work to define what a minimum income guarantee could look like for Scotland, including costs and delivery, is led by an independent steering group. This comprises of a strategy group of cross-party MSPs, including Miles Briggs, and an expert group from across the third sector, industry and academia. The expert group published an interim report which sets out early considerations for a minimum income guarantee in March and will publish a full report next year, which I expect to include consideration of the costs of a minimum income guarantee.
Annie Wells.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer. As the Cabinet Secretary had mentioned, the Government's working group for minimum income guarantee was established almost 2 years ago, and yes, it did produce an interim report in March. But it contained absolutely no information on the two most important questions, the level of the income guarantee and how much it would cost. Until the Government sets out the cost, this plan is a fantasy. But in 2 years, they still haven't managed to even do that. So why is the SNP Government wasting time and resources on pie-in-the-sky proposals?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I think that's a deeply disappointing question from Annie Wells. And I say that because when we were at the Anti-Poverty Summit, not just a few weeks ago, This was one of the areas which many campaigners strongly urged government and opposition parties to look at. That doesn't say it's a simple answer, and it doesn't necessarily mean that it's all deliverable within the devolved context that we are in. But I think it is deeply disappointing to see that Annie Wells's ruling aspects out, and I would presume that the questions that she has raised today have been issues that, for example, the cross-party group of cross-party MSPs that are on the strategy group are also challenging the expert group on.
A supplementary, Colette Stephenson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The current cost of living crisis, which is unprecedented in scale, comes on top of a decade of Tory austerity, exposing the insufficiency of UK government's safety net. What difference would it make if key welfare and employment powers were held here in Scotland?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I think one of the challenges that we do have when we're looking to see how we can tackle poverty in Scotland is what we can do within the powers that we have. Now, we've seen with the game-changing Scottish child payment that the Scottish Government is determined to move forward with what it can do here. But it is clearly the case that if we continue to have the vast majority of welfare and indeed all of employment powers held by the Tories at Westminster, we will consistently be held back in what we can actually do here.
Question number four, Sandra Gohani.
To ask the Scottish Government what action it is taking to encourage house building in Scotland.
Minister Paul McLennan.
Over the course of this Parliament, we are making available £3.5 billion to support the delivery of more affordable homes. Within that £3.5 billion, we have published five-year local authority resource planning assumptions, totalling £3.221 billion. This has provided the confidence, certainty and assurance that the housing sector needs to deliver progress towards our ambitious 110,000 affordable homes target by 2032, and building on an achievement of having delivered over 118,000 affordable homes since 2007, over 83,000 of which were for social rent.
Sandra Gohani.
Well, despite that answer, recently a £200 million project by the Get Living Built to Rent specialist aimed at building 1,500 homes in Glasgow was put on hold, with a spokesperson for the group saying rent controls have unintended consequences that only serve to exacerbate the underlying problem. Will the minister admit that his government's rent freeze has negatively impacted house building, and will he support Scottish Conservative calls for a housing delivery agency?
Minister.
Analysis of that policy is still going on at the moment, and I'm sure that Mr Harvey will pick up that in due course. I think there's a key thing in terms of the first question that you asked, and there's a context. Only today we've seen the 12th interest rate rise in a row to 4.5%. Construction inflation is also at 20%. And when it comes back to his own area, we've seen a 17% rise in funding from the last Parliament in Glasgow area, and South Lanarkshire, which he always covers, is a 30% rise in that. I've just met a Glasgow Council yesterday in terms of that and discussing how we take that programme forward.
Supplementary, John Mason.
Thank you. Social rented and affordable housing is incredibly important for my constituents. Can the Minister say any more about the £3.5 billion programme he's already referred to and how it's being targeted?
Minister.
Yes, thank you. I'll probably refer the member to just the question I gave, particularly in his own area in Glasgow, around about the ambitious funding programme and increase that we've done that. So, as I mentioned, over £3.5 billion has been directed towards delivering local authorities' strategic priorities, and I'm planning to meet as many local authorities as I can, including Glasgow, which I met with yesterday. Now, 70% of these need to be delivered for social rent. From April 21 to end of December 22, the programme has supported delivery of 12,430 homes for social rent, 77% of which were total affordable homes delivered during this period. We're also supporting home ownership for those who need support through our Lift Shared Equity Scheme, which helps people on low to moderate incomes buy their first home, with 1,678 households having benefited from the support in the same period.
And supplementary, Pam Duncan-Glancy.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Constituents have contacted me concerned about the accessibility of their homes. Despite properties being advertised as wheelchair accessible, there are no fire evacuation procedures for disabled tenants, and if there were to be a fire, they'd be stuck in their homes and unable to get out. What could the Scottish Government do to ensure that emergency escape routes for disabled people are designed in homes and implemented when building properties from the start?
Minister.
Yeah, I think broadly there's a fair needs assessment which has been prepared at the moment in terms of how we tackle that particular issue. And the issue that you raise, I'm happy to pick up any specific issues you have and come back to you on that matter.
Question number five, Paul Sweeney.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on the delivery of the Scottish Welfare Fund.
Cabinet Secretary.
The Scottish Welfare Fund provides an essential source of crisis support and helps with independent living. Since it began in 2013, in excess of £380 million has been paid to more than 500,000 households. As set out in our response to the recently published independent review, we are working with local authorities and stakeholders to put in place an action plan with agreed improvements so that the fund continues to deliver for those in need.
Paul Sweeney.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Research into the cost of living crisis from the Poverty Alliance and the Scottish Women's Budget Group last year recommended better promotion of the Scottish Welfare Fund. However, it has been put to me that Glasgow City Council feel they can't promote the fund as it is oversubscribed, meaning that many low-income families in the city are unable to access this lifeline support. And given how much local authorities like Glasgow rely on central government for funding, will the Cabinet Secretary commit today to providing councils with the resources they need to deliver this fund to families who desperately need it?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, it is certainly our obligation of local authorities to promote the fund to those who they think would require that or are in need of it. And I take the question from the member in good faith, but I would say to him, this is my second portfolio questions in social justice. This is the second time I've been asked by a member from the Labour benches to be spending more on something. It is all very welcome, and I will listen very seriously to suggestions about how the government can and should spend more money. But we also have to have a discussion about how that could be paid for, and that is a discussion I would be more than happy to take forward with the member as we move forward.
And supplementary, Miles Briggs.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer, and apologies for not being in the chamber at the start of these questions. As part of the Scottish Welfare Fund, we see community care grants. And can I ask specifically what plans the government have to reform the application process for families and individuals caring for someone who've been released from prison or young offenders institutions, specifically for these payments to be made before they leave these institutions?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, the member raises a very important point. Clearly, we have had the review into the Scottish Welfare Fund, and we are in the process of working out an action plan on that. If there's something that can be done in this area, I'll be happy to update Mr Briggs on that in due course.
And supplementary, Marie McNair.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The Cabinet Secretary will be aware that a big hit on the Scottish Welfare Fund is the mitigation of the UK benefit sanctions. Does the Cabinet Secretary share my astonishment, and I'm sure the astonishment of Mr Sweeney, that Labour have reneged on the pledge to scrap universal credit and will keep the sanctions regime? Therefore, is it not clear that change isn't coming?
Cabinet Secretary, for matters within your responsibility.
Well, I think it is a concern that we are seeing the UK Labour Party reneging on a number of pledges they have, and the importance of that to the powers of the Scottish Government and therefore the responsibilities of the Scottish Parliament is how challenging it is for the Scottish Government to continue to have to mitigate against UK Government policies. And it is therefore deeply disappointing, but unfortunately not surprising, that there is very little difference between the UK Labour Party and the UK Conservatives on a number of benefit sanctions. And that's deeply disappointing, but particularly shows that Scottish Labour continue to be the branch of the UK Labour Party.
Question number six, Sharon Dowie.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what action it is taking to tackle homelessness in South and East Ayrshire.
Minister.
Our Ending Homelessness Together plan sets out how we will prevent and tackle homelessness nationally through the implementation of Rapid Housing, scaling up housing first and introducing no homeless duties that will ensure all public bodies work together to prevent homelessness. Since 2018, we've provided £1.94 million for the local Rapid Rehousing plans in the two local authority areas. Additionally, they receive over £1.24 million annually for homelessness prevention. We have also made available over £132 million for affordable housing in the two local authorities over this parliamentary term, which is an increase of 17% on the previous term.
Sharon Dowie.
Thank you for that answer. The number of homeless applications for July to September has increased by 60 in a year in East Ayrshire and by 41 for the same time period in South Ayrshire. So can I ask what engagement he's had with both local authorities and what specific plans do ministers have to develop a solution to rural homelessness?
Minister.
Yeah, can I thank the the member for that question. In regards to meeting local authorities, I've already met Edinburgh and Glasgow and would be happy to meet with the two local authorities that you talk about to talk around about what their plans are and go into more detail in that regard. I think in terms of looking at beyond, we talked about the rapid rehousing programme and so on in that regard, and I think there's more work needs to be done in that with the local authority in that regard. So happy to offer a meeting with the member to go and discuss with the two local authorities.
And a supplementary from Bill Kidd has been requested, and I'm happy to take, but I would remind Mr Kidd that this question relates to tackling homelessness in South and East Ayrshire. Bill Kidd.
Yep. And can the Minister explain... thank you very much, Presiding Officer. Very handy. Can the Minister explain how proposed powers to raise council tax in South Ayrshire and on second and empty homes could help tackle homelessness by maximising the use of existing housing stock across the country? Thank you.
Minister.
Our aim is for everyone to have a safe, secure and warm home. Local taxation is one measure that can influence ownership patterns and availability of homes to meet local needs. When we introduced powers in 2013 enabling councils to vary or remove council tax discounts, the number of second homes reduced and the revenue generated was ring-fenced for local affordable housing. Extending these powers to enable councils to choose to charge a council tax premium could further encourage behavioural change in how we use homes, and I look forward to seeing the responses to the current consultation on this proposal.
Question number 7, Stuart McMillan.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what steps it is taking to tackle child poverty in the Greenock and Inverclyde constituency.
Cabinet Secretary.
We are providing a range of support which will benefit families in Greenock and Inverclyde and indeed across Scotland, including investment in the Scottish Child Payment, 1140 hours of funded free childcare, free bus travel for under 22s and the Scottish Welfare Fund. Our five family payments, including the Scottish Child Payment, could be worth over £10,000 by the time an eligible child turns 6 and over £20,000 by the time the eligible child is 16 years old.
Stuart McMillan.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that reply. And the Cabinet Secretary will be very much aware of the Trussell Trust's end-of-year figures for 2022-23, which indicate that the number of food bank parcels distributed in my constituency rose by 36%. Now, the figures for the whole of Scotland did show that the Scottish Child Payment seems to have had an impact, as the rise of the number of households with children receiving food bank parcels was nowhere near the levels experienced elsewhere in the UK. But I am still concerned that it wasn't enough to protect every family from food insecurity. Does the Cabinet Secretary therefore agree with me that this shows that Scotland is taking a different approach to tackling child poverty? And if the UK Government isn't prepared to match progressive policies like the Scottish Child Payment, it should devolve necessary powers so we can go further to help low-income families in Greenock and Inverclyde and also across Scotland.
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I think it is very easy to see the contrast, Presiding Officer, between the approaches of the Scottish and UK Government. You have the Scottish Government that not only introduced the Scottish Child Payment, but has now went from that original campaign ask of £5 to the position that we are in at the moment. And that is very, very important. At the same time, of course, you had the UK Government cutting universal credit by £20. And I think that is the real challenge, is that, for example, we are spending £84 million making that available to local authorities, spend on discretionary housing payments, for example, directly to mitigate against UK government welfare policies. And that is a frustration, and it should be a frustration for everyone in this chamber.
And question number 8, Ariane Burgess.
To ask the Scottish Government what discussions it has had with local authorities regarding any preparations for the potential impact of the proposed illegal migration bill on asylum seekers currently accommodated in hotels in Scotland.
Minister Emma Ruddick.
The Scottish Government is deeply concerned that the UK Government's illegal migration bill will push people deeper into exploitation and destitution. We have urged the UK Government to stop the bill and focus on improving the asylum system to increase the quality and speed of decisions. This would reduce the number of people accommodated in hotels and the risk that they are left in prolonged limbo without the ability to work or access services. Asylum and providing accommodation is entirely reserved to the UK Government, but of course has an impact on our local authorities. So I will discuss this with the COSLA spokesperson for community wellbeing when I meet her shortly.
Ariane Burgess.
I thank the Minister for that response. Moray Council and Health and Social Care Moray will be supporting people seeking asylum arriving in my region over the coming weeks. How can the Scottish Government support the oversight group to ensure our communities are fully involved in welcoming these new residents and that we do not see a repeat of the short-notice changes to accommodation arrangements seen in other areas?
Minister.
The new Scots Refugee Integration Strategy provides a framework which can help planning to support people seeking asylum in line with our principle that integration should be supported from day one of arrival. New Scots was developed in partnership by the Scottish Government, COSLA and the Scottish Refugee Council. Asylum and accommodation is reserved to the Home Office, which should engage with local authorities as early as possible. We believe the Home Office also needs to provide long-term funding for local authorities and services, which recognises the true costs of asylum dispersal to local authorities and enables better support for people seeking asylum as well as those local communities.
And supplementary, Ivan McKee.
Thank you. As the Minister has outlined, the Scottish Government, councils and the third sector have worked well to implement Scotland's New Scots strategy, which supports refugees and asylum seekers into our communities from day one of arrival. For Westminster to disrupt this good work would be unforgivable. Can I ask what communications the Scottish Government has had with UK Government counterparts to express Scottish communities' opposition to this bill?
Minister.
Yes, absolutely. The Scottish Government has made our opposition to this bill very clear. The Cabinet Secretary for Constitution wrote to the UK Government in March to say that we condemned the bill's cruel and inhumane provisions and to urge them not to proceed with it. On the 25th of April, the Cabinet Secretary for Social Justice again wrote to emphasise Scotland's significant concerns and our intention to table a legislative consent memorandum due to clauses which alter the executive competence of Scottish ministers and to point out the opposition of this Parliament to the bill following a recent motion passed.
Thank you, Minister. And that concludes portfolio questions. There will be a short pause before we move on to the next item of business to allow frontbench teams to change position should they wish. Thank you.